for today. We'll talk about the age of AI, AI basics, then Power Pages overview, Power Pages Copilot, GitHub Copilot, and then we'll look into demos. So first leg of the presentation is heavy on theory, but the most part of the presentation will be hands-on, okay? I hope it all works. I like to do hands-on. I don't like videos. Hopefully this still works. It worked last night, so no guarantees, okay? If it doesn't work as expected, we'll find a way out, okay? And the organization wanted to bring Tom Cruise here, but they had budget constraints, so you stuck with me for a few extra minutes. Age of AI. So the age of AI, it's marketing a transformative era within technology. It's nothing new, although we are hearing more about it. It's said that mid-20th century foundational theories by pioneers like Alan Turing, who proposed the concept of machines being capable of intelligent behavior, right? And from the 1970s all the way up until now, we see this concept evolving. If you use Dynamics 365 or even CRM, you saw a push from Microsoft on predictive AI use for sales or best way of attending your customers within the customer service workload. So AI is not necessarily new, but generative AI with LLM models is, we see a rise of use of those things as of maybe the last 12 months or even 24 months, right? If you have connected to the internet, you've seen lots of AI products or models being released in a large scale. First ones is GPT. ChatGPT is a hit. It is here to stay. There is no way out. I feel sorry for teachers, people in the education industry, because I'm using it daily. I don't trust it 100% in terms of what it's producing, but it does help me get started. It helps me with content for articles. It helps me with some of the video text that I use. So it does help me a lot. But you have GPT-4 as one of the LLM models that's mostly used. DALL-E for image to text to image AI model. You have Sora. Who has heard of Sora? Sora is text to video, and it's freaking awesome. It's like, I don't know what's going to happen with Hollywood after Sora, so we'll have to wait and see. This is one of the latest OpenAI models, and then you have others. Of course, the one that we will see most use is Codex. Codex, I'm off for some reason. Can you still hear me in the back? All right. If I speak louder, I'm not yelling at you, so don't feel intimidated. So Codex is prevalent across multiple areas, even within Power Platform. So when you ask for support on how to write a Power Automate expression, for example, or if you're using GitHub Copilot and it does autocomplete your suggestions for you, that's all based in Codex, okay? But those are the most famous ones. There is one here called DeepMind. This is more prevalent within the science arena. And there are many others AI models available today. When it comes to AI, what is important for us to learn is how do I leverage AI in my day-to-day tasks, all right? And this is where I came up with the concept of ProPilot. You know, Copilot won't do everything for you. Just like you go to ChatGPT and you put a prompt in and you try to get things done and you see incentives, you see repetition of words like delve, deep dive, things like that. The text is not 100% perfect for you to use. What it generates is not 100% perfect, but it does a good chunk of the job, at least to get you started, right? But the results of an AI interaction will be deeply rooted in the quality of your prompts. So prompt engineering becomes key for what you expect the AI model to generate back to you. Okay. So the whole idea of, my goodness, we have GitHub Copilot doing an awesome work in producing code. It's going to take my job. I'm going to get fired tomorrow. I don't think it's quite true. Hey, Russ. I don't think it's quite true yet. You need a pilot besides your co-pilot. You need somebody who understands enough of the technology to be able to create good prompts, even if it's using natural language, to get to the end results that you expect. So rolling out this fall, we're going to be doing a zero to hero, becoming a pro pilot. The whole idea is we wanted to coach folks on the art of prompt engineering. And we're going to start from Office M365, the Office application tools, and then we're going to go all the way into Power Platform and eventually pro dev strategies there as well. So folks like April Denham spoke with Scott Duro. We're going to have lots of good people providing this content for you free of charge. Okay. Raz, I told them that you wanted to bring Tom Cruise here for this session, but due to budget constraints, you stuck with me today. All right. So when you build a prompt, you got to be specific. You got to make sure you're telling your AI model what you want to extract out of it. You should also provide context. Don't start with things like, give me a photo of a cat. It will give you a photo of a cat. It could be, you know, the hairless cat. What is it? Yeah. Yeah, I should know that. but if you give specifics, you're going to get the best results. If you give context, it will understand from where you're coming from in asking the AI model for specific answers, okay? And the third point here is iterate. If you don't get the result that you expect, provide a little extra sauce to that prompt so that you give a chance for the AI model to give you back what you want, okay? Then when you iterate, use the 3R rule. Go ahead. It really depends on who's paying you first. Because as a developer, you want to build everything from scratch. At least if you still have hair. I was a developer like that, but I lost too many nights with deployments. And that's what brought me over to Power Platform. I don't want to start everything from scratch anymore. But if your customer is paying you for that length of time and you like to develop from scratch, then I would say probably don't learn too much about prompting, right? But if you don't have the time, and there is only so much space in my head with work, mentorship, family. I don't want to memorize all the parameters that are required to do a hover over special effect on my div, for example. I think it's a waste of space in my head when I can ask Copilot to give me that information. So you got to work that balance out, right? Of course, you can't really leverage AI to the largest extent or to the farthest extent if you don't understand a particular concept, right? You may go like I did the other day. I asked ChatGPT about Sora, and I was talking about Copilots just a minute or two ago. Interacting with ChatGPT about Copilots, and then the whole extract or the whole paragraph that it wrote had nothing to do with Sora. It said, well, Sora is going to be used in this Microsoft Copilot. No. Right? It is an AI model, text to film, to movies, built by OpenAI. It had nothing to do with Microsoft. So if you don't have an understanding of the concept that you are interacting with the particular AI model, then you most likely not going to get the result that you you want, or even if you get the result that's expected, you won't be able to judge if that is, you know, if what AI is providing you is good or not, right? And so when you are iterating, use the 3R methodology: rephrase so that you can get better results, reframe, and retry. Okay, I find that when I am specific, when I use good context, and I iterate, I get the best results out of AI. Okay. All right, AI in Power Pages. Okay, so for those folks who haven't used Power Pages yet, Power Pages is the Power Platform tool for enterprise websites. If you want to bring external users into your life cycle, be it your customer, let's say your company or a customer has an implementation for with using Dynamics 365 customer service, you're the one of those guys to send an email to create a case. You could create a web application. They can go there and they can submit an email or a case from that website. Okay. If you're servicing a customer that uses sales for Dynamics 365, you don't want to get a lead or an order through an email. You want to provide a website so they can get in and submit that order through a website. So Power Pages fits that bill within the Power Platform stack. Okay. So when it comes to AI in Power Pages, you have a handful of options. Now, at the current state, and I know I'm being recorded, so I'll be careful in what I say here. Maybe I'll give you an unfiltered view of some of the features here when I'm not being recorded. But at current state, the AI experiences for Power Pages are not great when it comes to maker users, when it comes to the seats and developers. All right. What Microsoft is proposing is awesome, and I hope and I think we'll get there, but it's not great today. So when it comes to maker experience, you have three main features or four main features that makes AI in Power Pages or Copilot's assistant for Power Pages makers, okay? You have the AI generated site, and you see a screenshot here where you describe using Copilot, you describe to Copilot that you are creating a website and you tell Copilot what this website is about. All right. Today, Copilot has no ability to infer to your data model to extend this particular user experience. So if you say, if you have a model in your Dataverse that is used for events management, and you tell Copilot that you want to build an events management website, it will create pages with content about events management. But it won't go down to the model and say, well, you have an events table. Let's list all events that you have in this table as a list within Power Pages. Or let's create a registration experience because you have a registration table in your data model. So we don't have that yet. I wish we did, and I hope we'll get to that particular level of automation, okay? The second option here, when it comes to maker experiences, web page creation. So you can tell Copilot, go ahead and create a page that needs to do this, that, and the other, okay? It will create content within a page and offer you those possibilities, all right? Now, still doesn't look into the model, still doesn't refer to pages that already exist to see if it could refine. And this page creation, as the name implies, only works for creation of the page. You can't really refactor a whole page using Copilot. You have to go section by section and then try to change it as you work it out. All right. You tracking with me so far? Third option is AI generated content. You can highlight a text area within a page, and then you can ask Copilot to write content or to refine the content. And if we have time, I'm gonna look at some options there. You can choose the tone of the content. You can ask it to refine once it gives you the first option. That feature I find interesting. Because if you are building a POC or a proof of concept or an MVP, and you don't have much time to provide a shell of a website, that comes in handy. You can ask Copilot to fill in the blanks. So instead of using just bogus text or content, Copilot can give you that starting point for you. Go ahead.
Will Copilot be able to look at content inside your tenancy to try and build that? So if you had some data,
No, you have to ask it to build. So what you could do is, which should be a little bit of manual work, you could go to your content. If it's just a couple of sentences, grab it and say, based on this content, write me this, right? But it's still contained within the prompt itself, okay? All right, and then finally, the last option when it comes to Maker experiences, AI-generated components, all right? And this is fresh out of the oven. The only experience that was available up until this week was basic forms. You could ask Copilot to create a basic form. It would go down to your Dataverse and create the model for you and the Dataverse form and also the Power Pages form for you, all in one shot. The only problem with that experience today is that it does not infer to existing data structure. So if you have a table that does in a specific, that was created for a specific purpose, and you're trying to create a basic form here using Copilot, it will create another table for the same thing, which is not ideal. But Microsoft released the Copilot experience for multi-step form, and that particular interaction looks at the existing Dataverse setup. So I'm guessing it's just a matter of time before the two teams at Microsoft join hands and they work on the same in the same fashion. And I see where I see this going is eventually same experience will be available for lists and any other data bound experience within Power Pages. So far, so good. All right. Okay. Finally, the part that really matters, the last item here in terms of AI and Power Pages is the AI generated code, right? This is for pro developers only. Although, if you are a maker and you understand a little bit of code, you would be able to leverage this, right? Because you're giving Copilot instructions in natural language, and Copilot is converting that to code for you. Now, you would need to get yourself educated a little bit to see if the output of what Copilot is building is good enough for you, okay? Now, big thing to highlight here is that there is a chat window called Power Pages Copilot that you get when you view code from vscode.dev. When you are in the browser and you're looking at code for Power Pages, you open it up, you have a chat window there, you have a similar chat window in the desktop, but they are somewhat different, okay? What you get on the web, what you see on the web is not the same that you have in the desktop experience, and I'll show you what I mean. But the web version, you have an option to get it to generate code for you, and if you inquire of it, it can explain some parts of the code for you as well, okay? So you could use prompt as is, write code for web API calls, Power Pages web API calls, write JavaScript for field validation, and it will do a decent job for you. You still need to know a little bit about how things work between JavaScript or Liquid tags, for Power Pages, but Copilot will do good work for you, okay? But this is not GitHub Copilot, all right? This is Power Pages Copilot. This is not GitHub Copilot. Now, GitHub Copilot, it is by far my favorite Copilot of them all. If you haven't used it, I strongly advise you to use it. It's a paid product, but you get 30 days free of charge. If you code any language, this is your best friend, okay? This is, it's awesome. It's the closest thing to magic that I've seen in my life. Okay. It's also been around for quite a few years now. I think the first version of GitHub Copilot was available in June 2021, but with the use of large language models and the integration with tools, we see a rise of people using it, especially within Power Platform. Okay. Now, because it started a few years back, you have all this history collected from GitHub Copilot at our disposal, right? It's not only using your opinion about what it generated, it's using the opinion of all the users that have used GitHub Copilot up until now. So the amount of Power Platform developers today compared to the amount of all developers today, it's a small number. And GitHub Copilot will leverage the whole population, okay? Of course, that when it suggests things to us, it will suggest within the context of Power Platform if the prompt that you are building relates to Power Pages code or even a Power Platform related code, okay? All right. Now, even being as good as it is, GitHub Copilot will do the best work for you when it comes to boilerplate type code. I need to start at this. I can't remember how to start. Please help me out, right? And then you can ask GitHub Copilot, and we're going to show an example here, to refine the code according to a particular set of requirements. So it's not going to do that. That's the main difference between a maker experience and a code experience. With a maker experience, you give a prompt and you expect the whole enchilada to be ready for you, right? With code, you can have GitHub Copilot draft a piece of code, and then you can say, hey, forgot to ask it for this particular scenario. Highlight a piece of code and ask it to refactor for you. So that's the beauty of GitHub Copilot. It does work for writing unit tests as well, pattern matching, and then code explanation. All right. So, and then all the things that it does is you could start your code by commenting the code, what you would expect it to do, highlight those comments, and ask GitHub Copilot to generate the code for you. And you can do it reversely as well. You can write the whole code, highlight everything, and say, Copilot, document this for me. Okay, it does a great job at that. Price, individual cost, this is all in USD as of this month, $10. Per individual, business 19, enterprise 39. You can look it up and see the difference between those in terms of usage. For MVPs in the room, Microsoft gives, I think it's a $4 discount for GitHub Copilot. So it makes sense if you code, in my opinion. All right, let's write some code. Who is ready for this? Again, I like the live presentation. I hope this works. If it doesn't work, don't hate me for this, okay? All right, so the challenge is this. We are going to write code. Let me show this website to you. And where is my mouse? Right here, okay. Let's move this screen over there. Let's move this one there as well. All right, I think I am ready. All right, so this is a website. This website is built in Power Pages. By the way, we released an initiative called Power Pages Plus, where we are just making available a bunch of templates. If you don't want to start your Power Pages development from scratch, you can download these files. It's a solution-based websites you can install in your environments and just run with it, play with it. It's available for you free of charge, okay? This website was built using one of those templates. I'm going to sign in here and just show you what is our challenge for today. If this site ever opens. So basically, I have a website that's using virtual tables from Business Central. the site, the main functionality is I present data from the invoice table, data from the orders table, and then I have a third table that's not a it's not a virtual table called service requests. What I want to do is I want to list this data that's already there, okay, which is coming from Dataverse, all right? So what I will do is I just clear out the code for this particular web template. Okay, let me move this up. So this web template used to have code. That's the output of the template right there. I'm going to refresh. I'm going to sync. I'm going to sync my site and all of the content of that page will disappear. And then we'll start from scratch together. Okay. All right. So let's sync that. Let me make sure I have pushed this. Sync once again. All right. Internet connection is not helping, but let's start on the code side. All right. So here on the code side, I have my GitHub Copilot is enabled. And what I will do is I will open the chat window first. I'm going to start from scratch. So it's blank, right? And then I will copy a prompt that I had prepared in advance. Okay. So my prompt is this one. You can be polite and say good morning, Copilot, good afternoon if you want. But essentially what I'm saying is I'm working today as a Power Pages Dataverse developer. I'll be working on web templates that fetch and display well-formatted Bootstrap 5.2 pages. So I am giving my Copilot context of what kind of code I'll be writing today. Okay. So Copilot understood that. I'll go to my next prompt, which is giving information about what kind of model I will use on this particular task. Okay. So the primary table will work is called ideas underscore case, which is the logical name of my table. This table stores service request information. All right. So up until now, I'm just giving context. Then finally, what I want to do is I'll give Copilot an understanding of what this model looks like. Since Copilot is not connected to my environment, it can't really infer to that. So I'm going through each column and say, look, here are the set of the field definitions per column on this table. All right, so now I'm ready to write code or to have Copilot write code for me. So the first thing I want to do is I want to write a fetch command to query the data for me. Okay. So because I know how Power Pages work, I can be specific in how I instruct Copilot to write this for me. Write a liquid fetch XML statement to read the ideas underscore case table. So it went ahead and created the instruction for me. I can now copy that, throw that into my code. Then I can review this a little bit more. So I'll rename just for the sake of documenting my code well. Throw that in there. Then I'm gonna hit Control I and go to my next prompt, which is loop over records from my query and output each record as a Bootstrap 5.2 card. Okay. It went ahead and changed my code, and you can see here that it wrote it for me, right? So I will accept it for the time being, but I know that this instruction would not work. We are missing one option here, that's dot entities. I know that as a Power Pages developer, all right? But I got what I need for now, and we could test it. For the sake of time, I'm not going to test it. I'm going to leave it to the very end, and hopefully my example will work at the end, okay? All right. So next step is I want to aggregate information a bit better so that the users don't see a bunch of tags stacked up on top of each other, okay? So the next thing I will do is, let me copy this particular prompt because it's somewhat verbose. Where's my mouse? You see that the initial card is presenting the priority and also status code. We also know, I know that this data type in the model is a choice or option set. So this also would not work. So I will manually add this dot label to my status. I'll do this to status as well. It's there. I will highlight my card and move on to the next stage. Next stage is I want to aggregate maybe priority and label with a bit more criteria. I don't want it to be listed all in one stack. I want it to be grouped as a ordered list or, yeah, let's do that. So I'm going to throw this prompt here. Move priority and status to a flush list group, including containing priority and status. If priority is high, color code number as red. So let's see if it does the job for us. Okay, it changed. Come on. It changed my code a little bit. It added some options. I'll put it here. Hopefully this works. It's a lot different than it was last night. So hopefully it still looks nice. If not, we can refine it. Okay. Alrighty, so let's go to the next prompt. Power Pages uses Font Awesome for icons, so I can make use of that so that I can make my UI a little richer than just text. But a lot of times, or almost every time, I don't know what those icons, the icon codes are, right? And I shouldn't need to know. It's just a messy list of options. So, but I can ask Copilot to get information for me. So then my next prompt will be, I want to add the alert icon for the high priority cases. Let's see if it will do the trick for us. right? It's here. If the priority is high, it's going to do this. Now it's going to show something else. So I will accept it for now. I know that my label for priority use caps. So I'll change this to high. And I think we are at a good stage where I can publish this and see if it's actually working. Okay. All right. So let me upload these changes. Go back to my site. And see. All right, do you see it built what I needed? I got the icon, two places, not bad.
Nice.
Right, and we started from scratch. It worked for now. So let's extend this a bit more. I don't like that a card is taking this much space. So I know a little bit about Bootstrap. I know how we can work the presentation layout. So what we will do is we're going to ask Copilot to aggregate information or present information in a different fashion. Okay. So my prompt is my prompt this time will be around how Bootstrap works in terms of presenting the information. So we'll do Control I, throw the prompt. I want to make each card 12 columns wide at mobile resolution, so on and so forth. So if you know a little bit about Bootstrap, this will make sense to you. Let's see how Copilot's going to work this out. Now, it did what I wanted, but it added an extra div closing tag, and this will mess up my code. I will accept for now, but I have to clean this up. Otherwise, my page won't look correct. So save this. Go back there, republish. Refresh. And didn't quite do what I was expecting yet, because I'm the one missing the correct instruction. So we're going to extend this a little further. So let's go back to the code. And the reason why it's not presenting the columns side by side, it's because my HTML content is not wrapped within a container and row for Bootstrap. So I will highlight the whole for loop. Go Control I and say wrap in container, oops, and row divs. It created those objects. I will accept, save in the right place there. Wait for it to load. Let's wait. Now it's side by side. So it's good to go. Now, the last thing I want to show is, suppose that I had more information, or even for this particular case example, I have a lot of tags. Suppose that my customer said, Victor, I don't want to show the description here. I want to show it in a pop-up, right? So we're going to build a pop-up to show some of this information. For the sake of time, I'm not going to change the layout here to hide the description to only show there. I'm just going to create the pop-up, but you get the idea. All right. So now what I will do is I'm going to highlight my card once again. Control Y, and say, I want to add a footer to the card. What else? Containing a link to launch a Bootstrap. Notice how I always refer exactly what I expect it to do. If I did a, just a regular model and I had not informed Copilot that I am a Power Pages developer, it could just tell me to install maybe NPM and try to do this using React or some other tool. So you gotta be specific to what we expect it to do. It's almost like you're talking to your teenagers, right? You gotta take the trash at 5 p.m. today. All right. So let's see if it will build what we expect. Scroll down. It created the footer. It added some options. Here, I'm going to choose to accept. All right. Now, I don't have the code for the model just yet, but I will accept this code for now. For some reason, though, I don't see my closing for loop anymore. Looks like it's gone, right? Where's my end for? Yeah, it messed it all up. So let me step back. Okay, highlight this card again. Add a card footer with link to case details to be presented in a model Bootstrap model pop-up. Okay, I have it in the right place. I still have my for loop. Now let me see if it's going to do what it did last night, okay? When you hit enter, and it's not going to do this for me, but in some examples, when I hit enter here next, it kind of predicted the model part of this particular prompt, right? It didn't do it today for some reason, but I could still ask it, create Bootstrap model to show details of keys. All right. So I get all of the information that I need. Now, I have only 4 minutes before it's over. I would keep on building and constructing this story by highlighting the code and say, look, I wanted to pass the information that is already in the HTML. I don't want to query the database once again to populate my model. Do this for me. But you get the idea of how this will benefit you. Is essentially, you write a piece of code, refine, go on to the next requirement. Did it do what you expected it to do? No, give it more information, refine the prompt, get the results that you need. But even by making this effort of giving more every time, I was able to write code here that in the past, because you don't memorize all these commands, you're doing Liquid and you're doing JavaScript and you're doing Bootstrap and Font Awesome and all that stuff, you'd have to be everywhere to gather all the information before you would have a result. And we were able to write it in what, 20 minutes, 25 minutes maybe. So the whole idea of AI, once again, it's not going to do the whole job for you, but it's going to be available for you, almost like a Tino Ray that you can send an email and ask for reference on Power Pages, but he's not there with you side by side. Right. So that is the main advantage. You have someone pairing up with you in development and giving you answers 24/7. But you've got to be able to give enough content to get good results and also have the knowledge to evaluate what Copilot's giving to you. All right. So let me go back to the presentation. And I think I only have, let's see. Yeah, just reference to documentation. This was provided by Alexander Alashin. He's one of the guys that does a lot of Power Pages content online as well. GitHub Copilot Adventures is just a repo in GitHub that guides you through the knowledge of learning GitHub. All that I showed to you today was GitHub chat, GitHub inline support, but you have GitHub Copilot suggestions where you just expand on the suggestions that it gives. And you have a number of other things that the GitHub Copilot Adventures will coach you through. It's almost like it is a learning experience on how to leverage the Copilot power in your development journey. All right. And that is all that I have for today.